It
There it
says
is.
live. There it is.
There
We're
it is.
on.
It says live.
We're
It says
doing the
live.
thing.
We doing our thing
Oh
here.
man, I mean, I feel like I need a tissue. I gotta wash my hands. Something,
Man,
something.
we're
I feel like it's
just
gonna
you
get
off the
filthy
hands.
in here.
You got some Corona going on here?
I
Some
don't
Corona
know.
V going on up in there, man?
I'm just feeling. I know what we're talking about tonight. I
You
know where we're going. You know, I feel like
Oh
I need
yeah.
to make sure I got something to clean up with because we're
You
about
got
to get
that right.
dirty.
You
About to
got
get
that right.
filthy.
Hey, because if folks don't know, I am Kirk M. Samuels, and he's
And
Rick
I
Dunn.
am Jason B. Kendrick, the
Oh
Kendrick
yeah.
Catalyst.
We are the madmen of masculinity here. We're interrupting your boring life with all the chaos that's going on in the world, all the fear and all the everything else. And you know, we're just we're bringing this centered here. We got a fantastic conversation. We are just
Oh.
two, we're two guys just having some fantastic
Yeah.
conversation, man.
We're
And
just real
so
guys having real talk. And guess what? You get to, ladies and gentlemen,
ooh.
you get to see through the looking glass and see how we actually talk. I mean, two men working on themselves, working in the world, trying to heal men in this world, and you get to see us just do our thing. And
Yeah.
tonight, oh,
Or
tonight,
today, depending on when they're watching it.
that's
But yeah.
true. Could be today, wherever you are in the world
It's
right
night
now.
right now when we're recording it, but who knows when you're gonna watch this. This
This
will
day
live
of your
forever.
time, whatever this day of your time is right now, we have been asked specifically by several of our wonderful followers to
Our
our
constituents.
constituency, our fun fans and supporters and the promoting po folks out there that they want us to talk about sex and male sexuality.
Sex. Oh yeah. Oh, we're gonna get real today. We're gonna get real. Matter of fact, we're gonna get so real that we didn't even put this
No, it's not
on
going on Facebook.
Facebook. This is going on YouTube right here.
Straight on,
Because
straight to YouTube today.
this is getting real right here, real rugged and raw.
Raw.
Oh yeah, man.
I like
JBK. They
it
asked us, man.
raw.
They want us to talk about sex, man.
They
So
do.
hey, if you are easily offended, this might not be the conversation for
This might
you.
not be.
If you want it light and fluffy, and if you want it, you know, nice and surfacey, this may not be the conversation for you. If you don't want to hear guys talking about, you know, our sexuality and how we are, this may not be the conversation for you. But if you want a couple guys talking about some giving you the low, giving you the beneath the surface, the
The
how it is these
411
days, then we're gonna
on
do it.
that Y chromosome.
No, on that Y chromosome, man. We on that Y side of the chromosome, man. So I thought, man, hey, I got an idea for you, JBK. How
Uh-oh.
about
Throw it at me.
I got six V's. One, two,
Six
three, four,
Vs.
five. I got six V's that I want to throw out there, man. And
All right, I
let's see
got
if we
two
can
right
unpack this
here.
thing.
I'll
Well, yeah, you
add my
got six
two
right
in
there.
to
Boom.
your six.
We got six V's, man. And so let's talk about just guys and sexuality, man. Let's talk about the first V. The first V is visualization.
We
We're
are visual.
the eyes. We are visual creatures, man.
Yes.
We are visual creatures. And my theory is, ladies, if we're talking about sex, if his eyes are not involved, he's not involved.
That's right.
Everything that a guy's involved with, his eyes are involved with. You ain't never see a guy watch a sporting event with his eyes closed. And if somebody walk in front of the TV at the wrong time, it's trouble. So you gotta, I mean, his eyes are the windows to his soul, man. And his eyes are extremely important in terms of how visually driven we are as men. Man, what do you think about that, JBK?
It's so right on point because for us as men, as hunters, we're visual. We see, we know what we want by through our eyes. And so now the one thing I do want to preface is that just because we're visual creatures, once we get to know you, once we get into the heart space, the visual isn't as important. But initially, number one, visual is number one. But later on, so because I know I've had the conversation with a lot of ladies around sex and how they feel as they get older and their bodies change and they don't feel as attractive, that they're like, well, man's a visual creature, and so he's not going to want me. If you've got that connection, if you're communicating, if you're sharing with each other, he's still going to want you. So don't, but yes, I mean, as point of fact, we are visual creatures, but we do grow out of that with time, with love.
So
So
man, I tell you what though, man, I'm gonna push back on that one, man.
push back.
I think, you know, that foundational part of us as far as our eyes being the light switch, the springboard, man. I don't know if that in my experience anyway, I think it might change,
Yeah.
but I don't know if it ever goes away. Like,
I
and
know.
what I mean by that, I'm gonna get specific. Ladies, we want to see you. We want to see your bodies. Turn the lights on. turn the lights on if it's dark, if it's pitch black. See, women like it pitch black because a lot of women are self-conscious about their bodies and all that kind of stuff. No. Guys, we need to see you. We need the lights on. We want to look at it. We want to look at it go in. We want to look at it as it's going in and out. Yeah. We want to look at the curves. We want to look at the shapes. We want to look at you. And really, I think, and see, here's how I think it changes. I think from you know, once that deep bond comes there, I want to see her eyes. Mm. Like her eyes, I mean, whatever we doing, if I'm looking down at her or if she looking down at me or if she doing something or if I'm doing something or whatever, I want to look at her eyes. And so, I'm still visually drawn to her body, but I'm still looking. I'm looking at her hair. I'm looking at the way her eyes look and her eyebrows and the lashes. I'm looking at the way her mouth, you know, does that thing, the way it looks around, you know, I want to see. So it may not be, okay, let me just see, you know, let me see some breasts or let me see some ass or, you know, whatever. But to me, the visualization is still involved because I might want to see different things, but I still want to see.
Yeah, no, you hit the nail on the head. Like what I was trying to say was that we're so visual, but what we are looking at or what we're looking for, or those things change, they shift as we, especially as we get intimate, we get closer. You will stay as the woman will stay beautiful to us. We just mature. Mm-hmm. And so it's not just about you got to look like be a size 5 and look this way and have this much weight. We're still visual creatures, but you don't have to worry about staying that same size when we met you in high school or college or whatever.
Yeah.
If we're connected to you, we're still going to love you. We're still, and we still want to see you though.
Yeah.
Because this, I know I have, I mean, and Louis C.K. says this really well. Like the older I get, I like those mom bodies, you know, they may not be the most, you know, media driven.
Yeah.
You know, when you got that connection, it's like, hey, this woman, she's got some experience. She's got some miles on her. I want to see that.
That's true, man.
And we are visual that way. And to your point, I want to see.
Yeah.
You know?
And I'm okay if she got, I mean, especially at this age, you know, as we older, I'm okay if she got maybe some stress marks or something like that. If she had a baby, I get it. I got
my stretch marks.
I was 20 years old. So that's not a turnoff, ladies, that kind of stuff. If you got a scar from a C-section or maybe if you had some implants and you got, you know, a little, you know, I mean, that stuff is not necessarily a deal breaker. Mm-mm. In terms of us being able to see that stuff. And so, yeah, your point of us as we get older, man, I like that. I don't like that. I got a daughter that's in her mid-20s, man. I'm not, you know, I don't necessarily get turned on by all that stuff that media says we're supposed to get turned on by.
Yeah, I mean, it's like we're inundated with what the media wants us to think of as sexy and attractive. And yeah, you can look at a younger woman and be like, she's cute. Mm-hmm. But there's no substance there. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You know, and that's the biggest thing is like, yeah, we're visual creatures. And like we look at cars and we'll look at boats or we'll look at different things like pieces of art. We'll look at younger ladies. But then we'll also, for most of us, especially those of us that have done the work and are more mature in our ways, we'll have that second thought right after, like, yeah, but she young.
Yeah. And she don't know what she's doing.
Nothing, nothing drama in there.
She don't know how to tilt that thing. You know what I'm saying? She don't know
that's
how
just
to,
a lot of work and drama, and I don't need that.
I need somebody that, you know, that we can drive this thing together. You know, it's like sailing. Mm-hmm. You know, one of us might be on the helm, but somebody else is working the sails and all that kind of stuff.
This is a partnership. It's a teamwork.
I need somebody that's going to be, you know, an active participant in this thing. Assist in your own rescue kind of thing. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? So,
that brings up another good point that in my experience in my life, what has happened, and I've had some girls think I'm like bipolar and stuff, but it's not just me because a lot of men are the same way. When we're in relationship and we know we have access to your body, we know we have a steady supply of intimacy and we know we're going to get sex. We know we're going to have that release. We calm down a bit. Mm-hmm. We don't need it like every day. Mm-hmm. However, when we're single and especially out dating and stuff, it may be on our minds quite a bit more because we don't know if we have it coming. We don't know if we're going to have sex tonight or tomorrow. It's a surprise. And so it may be more on our minds. And I've had that experience when I first meet somebody and it's all exciting and the bubbles and the butterflies and all the things. Mm-hmm. And it's almost like I can't stop my mind from going there all the time. Mm-hmm. And so they get used to that and they think, oh, well, he's a hypersexual individual. Mm-hmm. And then we get together and then that kind of calms down. And then they're like, well, what happened to me? Yeah. No, it's just because, ladies, we're hunters. Mm-hmm. If we don't have a ready supply, we're hunting.
Yeah.
We're thinking about it.
Mm-hmm.
Once we have ready to fly, we can calm down and we know, and then we can relax. And it doesn't have to be this everyday, daily thing.
You know, but even in the hunting aspect of it, so that you bring that up, you know, part of the physiology behind our eyes, I mean, that's a hunting mechanism as well. That's that triggers our hunt, that triggers our salivation, that triggers, you know, our desire, you know, I mean, our visualization, our visuality, you know, that triggers our dopamine. You know, that a lot of women, I'll tell women, you know, you might not like your body, but the more you let him see your body, the more you will condition his eyes to your body, and he will enjoy it, even if you don't necessarily enjoy it.
Yeah, and I mean, that's how we grow together, we mature together. I mean, I don't like my body. I mean, because I still have that 18-year-old mindset where I think I should look the way I did in my 18 or to 25 or whatever.
Yeah.
But as we mature together, as we grow together, then what you have is what we want.
Yeah.
Let us see it.
Yeah, no doubt. And so you got it, ladies. Turn the lights on. I'm telling you, it's a red flag if he's not. And matter of fact, I'll even go there. If your man, I mean, I'm going to call it out.
Yeah.
If your man does not want to look at you during sex, when you're being physically intimate, if he does not want to look at you, if he has his eyes closed, if he wants the lights off, if he's looking elsewhere, he's probably not present with you sexually at that moment. He's probably fantasizing about somebody else. And quite honestly, he may very well, I mean, I'm not generalizing, you know, completely, but he may very well be using your body to masturbate about or to something else that he has watched or somebody else that he's thinking about. His eyes are important. So ladies, turn the lights on, open the blinds, let some daylight in during the day, turn those lights on, let him see you, let him see you in the shower, let him see you getting out of the shower, drying off. Don't come out of the bathroom fully dressed from head to toe. You know, show him some skin, you know, show him some body, show him your curves. He likes it. He wants it. That'll trigger all that kind of stuff.
Yeah. And ladies, if you want to turn the lights off and fantasize about somebody else when you're with your man, there's a whole nother issue.
That's cold.
I know it's not one sided. I've heard ladies be like, you know, I'm thinking about Brad Pitt while I'm with him. I turn the lights off or whatever.
I've heard that too.
And it's the thing. That's because we have lost the intimacy because you want to be looking at each other's eyes. You want to be getting into that soul. You want to be there. Yeah. So if you've lost the spark, I mean, how can you bring it back? Or do you want to bring it back? I mean,
Sex is a soul activity. And so, and the eyes are the windows to the soul. Yeah. So, you know, again, if our eyes are not involved, man, that's kind of a, you know, that's kind of a red flag, man. And so ladies, turn the lights on. Let us see it. We want to see the insertion. We want to see the penetration. We want to see
you. We want to see your face. We want to see your hair. We want to see your bounce.
We want to see your breasts move. We want to see all that kind of stuff, man. Yeah. I was really visual.
Yeah, you had it right there.
I'm flashbacking.
What's the second V?
But I know we just spent all that time on
the one.
Patient. How about variety?
Variety
is huge for men. Variety is the spice of life.
Yeah. And that's one thing. I'm glad you brought that up because younger men will assume, and when you're not as mature, you will assume variety means different women.
Mm-hmm.
However, once you age, you grow, you be with women, ladies are very flexible and they are very fluid, and the same body, the same woman will be different women. She'll be that young vixen. Yeah. She'll be that working mother. She'll be, you know, the wife, she'll be all those different things. So if you have a little bit of patience and a little bit of wherewithal, you will have the variety.
Yeah.
But we got to have these conversations though. We got to talk about, like, you know, when I talk about variety to your point, from a younger perspective, you know, that might be just a number of, but when you get kind of older and settled into that whole thing, you can learn that we can have variety in a committed singular, you know, a singular relationship where we can do it different ways, different places. We can role play, you know, we can, sometimes it's crock pot, sometimes it's microwave, you know, sometimes it's like, look, girl, I'm going to bend you over here right now. We're going to, you know, sometimes it's
sometimes you're washing the dishes. Sometimes we're going to do the all night Valentine's thing.
Sometimes it might be slow, and sometimes it might be like, look, you just going, I'm going to get it now. Like you going to take this. You know, and so I'm going to get it to you. You're going to take this.
But
variety is huge, and so we have to work on that. On that variety in terms of making sure it's not just singular, making sure it's not mono something. I don't whatever the word is, but
sexual, whatever. But yeah, and guys, listen, I mean, I know you get into these relationships and you're used to being out dating all these different women and stuff, and so that's your variety, but you get in these relationships and you get very mechanical, you get very robotic, and you do the same thing the same way, the same, you know, at the same time. And that will kill your sex drive, that will kill that sexual energy, your testosterone flow. So sometimes, gentlemen, it's time for you to get creative.
Yeah.
Don't just leave it up to her.
No. But at the same time, again, ladies, I mean, help us out with that. Mm-hmm. You know, ladies, you all have the ability to be more fluid than we are. Like sometimes we can get kind of set in our ways as men and structured and compartmentalized and all that kind of stuff. You all can be fluid. And so that there is an opportunity for you to help us in that fluidity. And help us get outside of that rhythm and that comfort zone. You know, men are real cadence driven and that kind of stuff. And so, ladies, you're able to be fluid. So offer us that gift. We got to have these conversations, though. And like, you know, hey, baby, I like this. I like that. What if we try this? What if we try that? You know, maybe you involve some toys involved in the whole thing. Or maybe, you know, again, there's different ways to have variety. Maybe she wears her hair different. Maybe she has, you know, this little outfit that she wears tonight or another.
You know that one I like.
Yeah, you know that one. You know that one with the snaps.
Right. You know I got the nurse fantasies. Wear that outfit. Get the
one with snaps. There's wrong with some role play again and having some variety, having some bring in some toys, bring in all that kind of stuff. But variety is huge, and visualization and variety, both of them help spike the dopamine levels, especially in men. And so, you know, I mean, variety is one of those. That's why we go to the grocery store and you walk through the produce aisle and it's this and then this. And they see all these different colors and all these different shapes. And I mean, variety is huge in our culture. You know, we don't eat the same thing every day because we as human beings are driven by variety. Variety is something that, you know, that draws and attracts us, and it keeps us interested. It keeps it new and fresh. And that's one of those things we can lose in long-term relationships is variety.
Well, and that's the second human need is uncertainty, which is basically variety. The first human need is certainty. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, we're contradictory beings.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, we need certainty, but that's the stability of the relationship. That's knowing that we're together, that we're working on it. And then having that uncertainty of not knowing exactly and having different foods and different things and doing different places. I mean, you know, if it's starting to get stale, it's time to go to the drive-thru.
Mm-hmm.
Get in the back of the seat of the car. I mean, relive
the car wash.
You know,
Can we get it in while we're going through the car
wash? And those things, I mean, you might potentially get a ticket if you don't watch the clock or pay attention, but that's variety. That's exciting. That, you know, that brings some fun into it.
You know, when you do the date night, maybe you don't have to wait till you get home.
Right.
Maybe you can get in the backseat of the car.
You can have dessert first and then have dinner.
I mean, you can, when you get back to the car in the parking lot, you can be like, look, girl, you know, I want you right now. Let's do this in the back of the car like we used to when we first got together. You know, like when you first get together, man, there's no limits. I mean, man, we just, you find some sneaky spots, you know, maybe some outdoor places or something where you can sneak in, whatever, you know. But either way, variety is
huge. Go defile City Park. I mean, it don't matter. It's something.
Hey, you know, but variety is huge. And like I said, from a neurological perspective, variety spikes dopamine. And dopamine is very, very good, very, very important. So does visualization, for sure. All right, visualization, variety, vitality.
Vitality. Well, variety breeds vitality.
Yes, man. Vitality, man. That's that sense of testosterone, that sense of and, you know, testosterone is not necessarily a bad thing. You know, nowadays there are a lot of women that are getting testosterone injections and supplements and that kind of stuff. And, you know, I've talked to women that have done it, and it is a game changer for relationships. I mean, ladies, if your sex drive is low and if you don't have any responsiveness in those areas, maybe that's something you want to explore with a doctor is, you know, getting on some kind of testosterone or hormonal, you know, kind of treatment and that kind of stuff. I've heard that can flip a relationship where the guys are like, yo,
whoa, you know, what happened?
This girl's off the chain, youngin'. So, ladies, that might be something you want to explore. Yeah. But vitality is huge, especially from a guy perspective.
Oh yeah, and that's where you get into what we need is that masculine and feminine polarity. Mm-hmm. What we need to have that to create that vitality is that polarity. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, ladies, if you're at work all day and you've been in your masculine all day, being aware of that, and you come home and maybe he's in the mood, but you're in your masculine, so you pick a fight.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of that, going, okay, I know I need to shift. And even having those, you have those conversations. Like if he's not aware, or he doesn't quite catch, like, oh, I need to help her get back into her feminine to create that polarity. Mm-hmm. Maybe you take that and say, I need a minute. I got to get out of work mode. I got to get back to my feminine. And then, guys, you got to help. You got to be there. You got to be supporting that because, if we're both running masculine, it's not going to work. And there are a lot of relationships that are almost opposite now, where the ladies are running more masculine and the guys are running more feminine. However, for just our natural makeup, it's more natural for the man to be in his masculine, to be the aggressor, and for the woman to be in her feminine, to be the receiver. You can do it, and for variety's sake, you can try it out. Guys, you can be the receiver and try it out, but it may not feel natural. I don't know.
Like I said, I've heard from multiple sources women that, getting on a testosterone regimen will change everything. Like
I've heard from women's mouths. So oh my God, I tore him up.
Yeah, like hey, I'm gonna tear you apart. But from a mentality perspective, here's a tip for ladies. I don't think any man would not want to hear you're my hero. And this is that hero factor that guys have. So ladies, here's a tip for you. The next time if you want to see a distinct response or reaction in your man or a man, but your man specifically, tell him you're his hero, or he's your hero rather. Tell him he's your hero. Tell him he's your hero on off times. Tell him he's your hero during sex. Like tell him, let him know like, if you want to see him rise, if you want to see his boat rise, then be the tide that comes in. And just flat out tell him like, you're my hero, and watch his demeanor change. Trust me. That's just a gold nugget. Some lady out there, you're gonna send us a message and thank us for this one. But tell him you're my hero. I don't know any guy that would not love to hear that from the woman in his life. You're my hero. Him that during sex, and oh man, you going, whoo, homeboy might try to rearrange something up in you.
Oh, yeah, the furniture might be upside down after that. That goes into a lot of those daddy fantasies, like call me daddy, who's your daddy? It's the same thing. It's that hero thing. It's that being in control, being in charge, being the man.
Yeah.
And ladies, if you are running masculine all day long and you come home and you're used to being in charge, if you can't flip the switch and allow him to be the man, then you're not going to get the loving you want. He's not going to pound it out if he feels like he's subservient or taking second fiddle. So
and let's be honest, ladies. Let's be honest, ladies. Sometimes you want your man to just hit, you want him to just crush it. Like sometimes you just want him to just wreck it. Like sometimes you don't want him to be passive and just, sometimes even if you are a woman that's, that's kind of more aggressive or more dominant, more mad, whatever it is. Sometimes you just want your man to just like come in and tear this thing up. Mm-hmm. And there's nothing wrong with that. No. There's absolutely nothing wrong with that. I'm telling you.
As a matter of fact, if you are running a lot of masculine energy and you're in that space, a great way for you to get back in your feminine is to really surrender to your man and let him just pound it out, and you'll just shift naturally. Yeah. So there may be a recipe like, okay, I'm coming home, honey. Get ready. Close the blinds and lock the doors because we're gonna get ready to make some noise.
I know a good buddy of mine, man. He said that when he and his wife really got into that masculine feminine dynamic, he's like, he said, man, he's like, man, she got a man. She didn't even, he's like, man, I don't use the exact words that he used, but man, basically he's like, I tear that thing up in a good way. Like, from the ravishing kind of thing, the whole David Data, but like the ravishing, ravishing her and all that. And so so vitality is huge in that testosterone boost.
Yeah. And another thing too is it always comes back to connection and conversation and talking about these things and knowing what your partner likes, knowing what they need, what they're in the mood for. But that vitality a lot of times can come down to the combination of the visual and the variety. You can come down to you acknowledging and really, for the most part, having a common purpose. Like we were talking about, sex really at its highest is about that spirit. It's about ascending together and creating that connection. So having that, we have this common goal of connection and getting deeper and, you know, cause yeah, there's so many different kinds of sex. I mean, what is it? The Greeks have like four different words for love, you know, agape story, whatever. But, it's that same kind of thing. Like something to help your vitality is having that goal.
Right.
Okay, today it's just about pound. We're going to pound town. Yeah. I'm going to get you over to the kitchen sink or in the bathroom, or whatever. That's your goal. Or maybe we have time and we're on our honeymoon or we're going on vacation. And now our goal is to connect deeper and deeper a soul connection and making it like ceremonial almost. Like you are worshiping your woman, guys.
Right.
Ladies, you are worshiping your hero. You are allowing him to worship you. I mean, that's part of that, you know, variety that we're looking for that brings that vitality is those things. Like, the quickie in the closet or in the car or worship love.
Yeah.
But when you're able to, when a lady's able to help pump that vitality in her man, when she's able to help instill that hero attribute to him, like he is your hero, then you'll see him come into a new place, especially in the area of sexuality, when you're able to instill that in him. And it is, it is a trust factor. And obviously this whole entire conversation is talking in a healthy relationship, you know, in all the healthiest ways. We're not talking about anything that gets all off into abuse and you know, all this other kind of stuff, but we're talking in the healthiest ways. But when you're able to instill that sense of hero in him, his vitality factor will go through the roof. Like, you know, like he will rise to that occasion.
Yeah. And I mean, and trust really, I mean, it does all come down to trust in the relationship. If you want something, ladies, gentlemen, and you have trust with your partner, all you gotta do is voice it, ask for it.
Yeah.
You know, and whatever you may think is kinky or whatever you may think is weird, whatever, if they trust you, if they love you.
Yeah.
Even if they haven't done it before, they'll give it a shot.
Yeah.
You gotta have these conversations, man. You gotta have those we gotta be able to have these open dialogues about sexuality within the context of our relationships, man. We're not talking about it in the relationship like we should. You know, and there's a lot of guys that have some shame around their sexuality, and so they don't want to come out of their shell, but their woman it wants them to come out of their shell, like the woman wants him to be more aggressive. Or wants him to be more assertive or whatever it is, and he won't come out of that. And so the way to do that is to tell your man, hey, I want to talk about this, and to, you know, how would you feel about this? Or what do you think about that? Or have you ever given any thought about this? And so a lot of times it's, you know, the woman is a great place to open up those conversations, but to ask him and to instill in him that you're safe. You're not going to judge him by his answers, because a lot of guys won't answer the questions because they think you're going to judge him if they really told you. Like, look, here's what I like. You know, if you want to know what I like, yeah, I like to get a gag ball and to have these conversations, you got to be able to be open to whatever he might say.
That's also the key, too, ladies. Now, what was coming up for me is you have to be the safe place for him, because in most of our minds, we've been conditioned to believe that if we were honest with you, you would not love us. If we were honest with you about the things we wanted, you would think we were freaky or crazy or kinky or something like that. If you were a safe place for him, that like he feels safe to be honest and open up to you, then he will bend over backwards and fulfill whatever fantasy you have. So you can be that person.
Or he'll bend you over forwards.
Forwards, backwards, upside down, you know, depends on how strong
you
are.
Whatever you want. But I had a conversation, matter of fact, just a few days ago with a lady that, you know, her man, you know, was just really timid, and she wanted him to, you know, she wanted him to like be more assertive. And so I was kind of coaching her along the lines of tell him this, tell him that. But a lot of it was making him feel safe, because if you want him to open up to you, you can't flinch when he begins to open up. You can't go ill. You can't, you know, you got to make him feel absolutely safe. But that all that will boost his hero factor, and his hero factor will boost his vitality.
And that brings up a good point that actually was talked about this at your party last night with somebody, about how we as men, we penetrate from our genitals, and women, you penetrate from your heart. Mm-hmm. And if you see how our bodies are designed, you know, women have the breasts. And so our hearts as men are our sensitive areas. Mm-hmm. This is what we protect, and this is what we need to feel safe with to express with you. Just like you don't want to just open up and receive any man, you know, that's your sensitive area. That's something that you hold sacred. So these are things we need to be aware of for each other. Like, ladies, you can't just come at his heart and just be like, open up, give it to me.
Yeah.
If he doesn't feel safe with you, he's not going to do that. Yeah. And that's make him shut down and run away. Just like if some guy came over and pulled your skirt up and was like, open up and give it to me.
Yeah. Yeah.
Uh-huh. You have to think about our hearts in the same way as you think about vagina and giving that to somebody.
Yeah.
With our heart.
And when a man is doing it right, she gets receptive. She gets wet. She gets moist. She melts. Yeah. And when she does it right, he melts. His heart will melt. I mean, he'll open up and get receptive, all that kind of stuff. And so it actually happens, to your point, the same way, but in just in a different manifestation.
I always visualize the yin yang.
Yeah.
Like the top, it's got the thing at the bottom. So like the feminine and the masculine, you can see those are different sides, and how we penetrate each other is just from different areas. But those are things to be aware of.
Yeah.
Penetrate his heart. I'm telling you, ladies, tell your man regularly that he is your hero. I mean, that will have an impact on your relationship. Use those words. This ain't like a, I'm telling you ish. I'm telling you, use these words. You're my hero.
Yeah.
Boom. I mean, you will see him. You will see a good man anyway, a receptive man, a man that's present and connected with you. You'll see his whole demeanor. You'll see his physiology change by hearing the words from his man. You're my hero. Oh, now he's getting wet in his heart. Now he's getting a little moist. Now, you know, that's foreplay for his heart.
And I would tell you too, if this is your first time doing it and you come at him and say, you're my hero, and he hasn't heard that from you yet, it may take a few times. And he might not have patience, because he may be a little skeptical, like, what I do, what she want, what's going on.
Just like if the man comes and starts to, out of the blue, you know, women do the same thing from a sexual perspective, like, all right, what's your agenda here kind of thing? And like, what you want? All right, visualization, variety, vitality. We're halfway there. Victory. Victory. No guy wants to be a loser.
Yeah.
Right? Every guy wants to win. All I do is win, no matter what. And what that relates to is a yes. What that relates to is hearing yes or feeling yes from his woman. And that yes is huge. That a no can shut him down big time, can trigger his rejection and all that. So a yes is huge in terms of him feeling like the victor, him feeling like the champion, the winner, especially in the area of sexuality. But that equals a yes. But obviously, JBK, what happens when she can't say, when, you know, the answer is not a yes? What can she do when she's not in the mood, or it's, you know, maybe time in a month, or maybe she's something there, maybe there's an obstacle in her saying yes. I mean, what can she do?
There are several ways to go about it. I mean, two things come to mind, first of all, but number one is make sure he knows it's not about him. Mm-hmm. Like, you have your thing and it's not about him. And if you're open to it, if you're not feeling too bad, if your body's not too bad, I mean, there's other things you can do to support him and his release if you're open to that. Mm-hmm. But one thing that also came to my mind is, ladies, and I don't want to be rude, but make it okay for your man to tell you no. Because I know there are a lot of ladies out there who are so conditioned and so used to being able to get it whenever they want, and they're the only ones that can say no. And I've actually had this experience in some of my relationships. I told a girl no because I was stressed out. I was not in the mood. I just couldn't get my head right. I was, you know, and I didn't have, since she wasn't the loving support for me to be safe with and to be able to open up about what was troubling me and what I was stressed out about. And, you know, not all men are this way, but for me, like, my libido goes down when I'm stressed.
Mm-hmm.
And so if I don't have that healing person with me that I can open up to, so I have said no. And then you might have thought I don't even know what the example, stole her car or something. And I said no. Like, she was so offended that I would even think that I could say no. And so that's part of our society now, ladies. Like, he needs to be able to feel safe. Just like you want to be able to say no and feel safe, he needs to be able to feel safe to say no too. But there's always workarounds.
Mm-hmm.
Main thing is, number one, because we all, as human beings, take things personally. Why did she say no? Why did he say no? What is wrong with me? I don't understand. Maybe it's not about you. Maybe he's just having a bad day. Maybe his stomach hurts. Maybe he's got to take a shit. Who knows?
Mm-hmm. I mean,
but number one, make sure he knows it's not his fault why you're saying no, if it's not.
Yeah.
If you are feeling like that's all he wants from you, you're not feeling heard, you're not feeling seen, you're not feeling cared for, mm-hmm. then you need to voice that.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I'm saying no because I'm not feeling it, and here's why I'm not feeling it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But
It's got to be a safe place. And to your point, it's not about them. It's not like, yeah, something right now. Quite honestly, you know, you're a man, you know, especially as you get older in age, he can't just get it up like that, like he could when he was 20. I mean, sometimes it will and sometimes it wouldn't. You know, it used to be you just sit around and you just walking around hard for no reason. You know, once you get up in, you know, a few years under your belt, man, you know, sometimes it's great. Sometimes he might just have a legit medical issue. You know, he might, if he takes blood pressure meds, you know, I mean, if he has something, you know, if he has straight up ED, whatever it is, maybe, you know, maybe that might be it. Or maybe to your point, he's got something going on, something in his head. Maybe he does got to take a dump, whatever it is. But either way, to your point, it being safe, and maybe it's not a no, maybe it's a yes. And maybe it's a, well, what can we do? You know, I mean, ladies, if you're on your period, maybe there's other things, you know, everything ain't on his period on your body. You know what I'm saying? I mean, you know, there's other ways that we can, you know, we can help satisfy, because what I would not want, if I'm in a deep committed relationship, I don't want to say no any more than I have to.
Right.
I want to be the place where that person comes for my yes. For anything. And again, maybe I can't do this, but I can do this. Yeah. Or maybe, you know, maybe whatever. I mean, a negotiation kind of thing. But yeah, I mean, but that victory, that yes is huge in both parts of the relationship.
Yeah, and be in that safe place when, whether in victory or defeat, those are huge things. Cause mm-hmm. I think that's where most of the issues come in the marriages and in the relationships around sex, around relationships. Cause we've stopped becoming the safe place. We've bought into this lie that, oh, you got to put on these airs and don't mm-hmm. tell my wife this, don't tell my husband that. Mm-hmm. I don't want to upset them. I want to keep, because we're like, oh, we have to keep it copacetic. Mm-hmm. You're on the same team. You're working for the same goal. Mm-hmm. You're lying to each other. If you're not the safe place for each other, then
yeah,
just you're killing the possibilities. And then the romance, I mean,
yeah,
it depends on your relationship. There's sometimes romance goes first. Sometimes it goes last, because some people, mm-hmm. I've seen some relationship couples that hide in their sex.
Yeah.
That's the only thing they got going that's working. So they'll hide in that instead of dealing with anything.
What happens commonly when we get in these long-term relationships or marriages after a while, what a lot of men experience is they'll come to the wife and the wife, and it's not even so much that the wife said no, but she shut him down and she rejected him and she made him feel, you know, ill, dirty, creepy, broken, nasty for, that's all you want is sex. Like, no, I ain't, you know. And you can tell a guy no so many times before he stops asking.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, I've had guy friends that, you know, I'll like, you know, hey, let's hang out, let's get together. And if I hear no so many times, I'm just going to stop asking. And so we don't want that to happen. We don't want it to be a shutdown no. Maybe it's a not now, or maybe it's a not that, but can we do this? You know, I mean, whatever. But you don't want it to be a shutdown no. So that victory is huge surrounding that word yes.
But on to the other point, gentlemen, if you're looking for a victory, if you're looking to get what you want from your woman, you need to realize how she gets turned on. She's not visual like us. She's not instantaneous like us. If you want, if you're already like, you wake up in the mood and you know that you got to wait till you get home that night, you need to start working magic beforehand. You start telling her how you feel, how good she looks, complimenting her, because she's like a diesel engine. You got to prime, you know, the glow plug's got to warm it up.
Mm-hmm.
It's not electric motor. It's not instantaneous.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
And if you just walk up to her and she's stressed out, she's had a hard day, you're like, hey baby, I'm in the mood.
Mm-hmm.
Expect to know.
Yeah.
Some attitude. But if you're aware and working on it and going, all right, you know, I want to have experience. I want to have some sex tonight. I need to start thinking about working on this now and start priming. Yeah. Motor, getting her wet and revved up and everything.
Yeah.
It's not a one-way street. It goes both. Yeah. You got to be partners in that.
And letting her know that, well, first of all, she making her feel safe. Yeah. And then secondly, making her feel desired. I mean, on a continual basis. Like, it shouldn't just be when, okay, I want to have sex tonight. It should be just a continual thing. I mean, letting her know she's desirable. Letting her know society tells women that they're not enough, that their bodies aren't enough,
that they don't look good, that they're fat, even when they're not, that they're skinny, even when they're not, that whatever it is. And so it's so as men, it's up to us to let her know on a continual basis, like, you please me. Like, I desire you. Like, I think you're beautiful. I love this part of you. I love that part of you. I mean, I love your maturing body. You age like wine. I mean, you're intoxicating, you know, that. I mean, it's up to us to communicate that and to make her feel safe and desired. And you know, guess what, ladies, men like to feel desired as well. I mean, so to let your man know that you desire him, to let him know that he still looks good or whatever it is. I mean, that can be huge. But yeah, sometimes you got to work that crock pot. Sometimes you got to work it during the day and send some text messages. And
yeah, you gotta, really, it's just little things. You know, we've been conditioned to all the romantic comedies and all the Valentine's Day holidays and Christmas and all these things. We're so conditioned to these big shows of love, these big shows of affection and these big things. But really, it's the little things over time.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you do those little things over time, which are much easier consistently, you won't have to do all these big shows. You won't have to, you know, buy out the flower shop on Valentine's Day because you've been at it all year.
Yeah.
Like, little things, show your affection. And it goes both ways. You're absolutely right. Like, if she's been on me, stressing me out, nagging at me all day, and then she's like, now give me some.
Yeah.
You gonna get it though.
Yeah, like, nah, you've been acting like a bitch all day. I don't want to, you know, I don't want all that kind of stuff. But being able to work that thing, man, being able to communicate that thing, being able to prime that pump is huge, I think, man. And, you know, it's huge to plant those seeds, man. Sometimes from a guy perspective, it's great to help her get out of her masculine. All day long, she has to make decisions. She has to make things happen. She makes things happen with the kids. They're you know, with dinners, with lunch. I mean, she is so consumed with all of the things she has to make happen. Sometimes she doesn't want to have to make things happen. Sometimes she just wants her man to say, we're going out tonight. Here's where we're going. You know, and, you know, here's the plan that I came up with. And I got it all set up. I got it arranged. I got daycare. I got, you know, I got babysitter. I got whatever. You know, we're going to get dressed up. Hey, here's what I need you to do. I want you to dress up. We're going to dress, you know, casual. Or we're going to dress nice casual. Or, hey, I want you to put on a nice dress because we're going out, whatever. But to take that off, that pressure off of her, and just you take the lead and you come up with a plan for something that you're going to do to help build that connection. Like, baby, you know what? Tonight, or depending on the circumstance, or this Friday or next date night or whatever it is, I got something arranged. And here, all you need to know is, this is the type of dress. This is the type of attire. And otherwise, I got it. We're going to go to golf if she likes golf. We're going to go to this restaurant. You know, we're going to go. I mean, you don't even have to tell her. You just tell her what she needs to know, which is how to dress.
Yeah. Keep in mind that whole sweep her off her feet thing, that isn't just in dating. That isn't just in the beginning. Like, if you can continuously sweep your girl off her feet, and that could take the form of when she gets home, like,
yeah.
Welcome home, honey. You're done. Mm-hmm. I've got everything else taken care of. You can go put your sweats on. You can go relax. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's sweeping her off her feet, getting out of those uncomfortable heels and taking the load off. Because for Superwoman syndrome that you heard us talk about, for nice guy syndrome, what is really aggravating the women, because they're in their masculine all day, they're doing the Superwoman thing, they're feeling like they got to do everything and look cute doing it and not ask for any help. Mm-hmm. And they're frustrated because guys are not taking over, you know, they're not being in control. They're not taking the, you know, sweeping them off their feet and taking that off of their hands.
Yeah.
So do that, sweep them off their feet, and not just in the beginning, but continuously.
Continually and little stuff day by day. All right, man, we got two more. Let's see if we can get through them in under 60.
Yeah,
we do. How about, what I say? Visualization, variety, vitality, victory, vacation. Mm-hmm. Vacation number 5, the escape, the getaway. This is the getting out of the norm, getting out of the monotony, getting out of all that kind of stuff, the escape. And it's huge because, and it goes back to something you said a minute ago, that when we get stressed, the chemical component of stress is cortisol. And if you look up the effects of cortisol, I mean, it basically just takes us out of all of our humanity, all the peace and calmness in our humanity. The perfect antidote to cortisol is oxytocin. And oxytocin is that escape from all of the stress that we have in our life. It's the vacation. It's the getaway. And so to be able to have a vacation, be able to get away, and maybe us getting to a different place,
physically, maybe that's getting to a different place mentally or space-wise or whatever it is, but that vacation is huge in the sexual chemistry, especially of him, of men.
Oh, yeah. I mean, the whole point, and I think this is what gets lost in, yes, marriages have turned, or partnerships have turned into businesses, and they've turned into these, you know, things to be managed, because you've got responsibilities, you got kids, you got mortgage, you got bills. Being those vacations for each other, like, ladies, let him know he's your hero, and helping him to relax. Guys, sweeping her off her feet and give, letting her relax. Being that vacation, being that safe haven, that oasis for each other.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if you're not, and I mean, I get it. It's such a multifaceted issue, because you got stress at work, and you think you can leave it at work, but you don't leave it at work, because you bring that shit home with you, and then you end up dumping it on your kids and your wife, mm-hmm. and everything, and vice versa. Being that safe haven where you can allow each other to vent. You can be that healing, you know, the port in the storm for each person.
Mm-hmm.
And giving those little vacations, like mm-hmm. having those little role play dates, or going off, just going to the motel for a night, having little mini vacations, you know, being that, I mean, safe place.
Yeah.
Ladies, gentlemen, you got to be the safe place.
Oh, man. All right. I'm about to, it just popped into my mind, man. And if you rewind this about 5 seconds, you'll see when the light just came.
Light bulb.
I'm speaking to ladies right now. This is a tip for the ladies. Vacation. Ladies, what if you had, well, I mean, everything was arranged and all that with the kids, and if that's the case and all that kind of stuff. What if you either texted him or left him a note saying, I'm so excited about this. What if you left him a note saying,
I gotta write this down.
Oh yeah, this is a tip for the ladies now. I mean, men too, but I think ladies, y'all could blow a guy's mind. If you could tell a man, I have a room, I got a hotel room, you know, depending on where you are, like let's say we're in the Denver suburbs. I got a hotel room somewhere on 16th Street downtown.
Down at the Brown Palace. I got the
corner. No, not even say the name of the place. Not even say the name of the hotel. I got a hotel room somewhere on 16th, you know, between 16th, whatever, maybe give them a couple block radius. I got a hotel room. I'm going to leave a key at the front desk. And when you get there, the only thing I'm going to be wearing, well, I may not be wearing much when you find me. And when you find where I am, I'm going to have this bottle of wine ready or whatever. But if you just tell him, I got a room at, I mean, you can tell him the hotel if you want, or you could just be more general and say, you know, it's in
you can downtown, turn it
down, downtown Golden. I don't know, whatever it is. Yeah. Make him go find you. Make him go from hotel to hotel and ask for you there and leave that key at the front desk, or, you know, hey, I got a hotel in the tech center, you know, somewhere off of whatever, Bellevue. I don't know. I mean, narrow it down and make him come find you, and then, you know, leave a little Easter egg in there and say, and when you get there, I'm just going to warn you, I'm not going to be wearing much, and this bottle of wine may be empty by the time you get there.
Mm.
Woo! Yeah. Man, homeboy going to be like Batman. I mean, just think about that from a vacation. It's like, first of all, you spike his hunt kind of thing. I got to go find her. And when I find her, there's a prize. And, you know, she might be kind of loosed up and all that kind of stuff when I get there. And, you know, baby, and oh yeah, by the way, I bought a new toy. Oh man, homeboy going to be busting down doors trying to find you.
You're giving variety. You're making stuff, visually. The vitality's kicked up because he's got to hunt you down, and you're creating a vacation atmosphere. Mm. I mean, guess what? You can take that same thing for the ladies.
Mm.
You can be like, honey, the kids are at the sitters or at the grandparents. Mm. I'm at a hotel on this block. She may not want to look for you.
But and see, that's why I think the looking for is a specifically a guy thing.
Yeah.
Like now, you know, like, you know, I think if a man took his woman to said hotel and the room was already decorated and laid out and roses and bath and all that kind of stuff, I think that may be a guy thing. But I think for a woman to tell her man, like, you know, give him a generality to come find you and to let him know hint wise as to what's going to be when he gets there. Oh man, I'm not going to be wearing much. I got a bottle. I got a box of wine and I got a new toy.
All right, ladies.
And wait,
smiles on our faces as we're talking about it. I mean, we're just giddy right now. Just talking about this. So,
If you just texted that to him and, yeah. Oh, man, I'm telling you. Homeboy.
All the stress. You forget about work.
You get all that kind of stuff. He is all like Don Quixote. And then, again, you take him out of that. You take him out of the stress. Now you've instilled, like I said, you've instilled the hunt. You've instilled the chase and all that kind of stuff. Now he's got to come find you. When he comes find you, and he knows that when he gets there, it's on like Donkey Kong, you know. I mean, I'm telling you, man. Guy, especially that good guy, oh man, he's gonna hunt you down like, I mean, like, man, he's Simba the Lion. I don't know. I mean, out on the prairie, he's gonna come get you. I mean,
all right, we got about 10 minutes.
All right, here we go. Sorry about that. Okay, so the last one: visualization, variety, vitality, victory, vacation. The last one is validation, identity.
So
the identity of who we are as men and the identity in our sexuality, man. What do you think about that?
Well, I mean, ladies, and you don't want to be overly exaggerative, but, you know, you want him to be your hero. You want him to feel validated. You want him to feel like he's doing a good job, because I don't know how many times we got to tell you, you validation, accomplishment. We like any dog, you give us treats, we will do whatever you want. Mm-hmm. Treats, scratch behind the ear, whatever. Mm-hmm. Every time you tell us what we did wrong, you critique us, you are griping at us.
Mm-hmm.
That's negative reinforcement. We need the positive reinforcement. We need the validation.
Yeah.
And it's not a feed the ego thing. It's a reinforcement thing.
Yeah.
You know, if you need your man to do something, you want him to do something, use validation, use positive reinforcement. If you're constantly nagging,
yeah,
that's going to stress him out. That's going to kill his sex drive. That's also going to just make him grumpy and angry. And then, which means he'll probably go hang out in the garage or at the bar or whatever to try to get away from you.
Yeah. I mean, and I'm telling you that is so huge. The affirmation / validation, that whole thing, man. And the reason I say validation, because it's a V, but basically, you know, so much affirmation that it becomes validation that you are his cheerleader. I mean, there are men that get paid millions of dollars to play a sport and they still have cheerleaders on the sidelines. I mean, to be that cheerleader for that man and to be that affirmation and that validation for him is huge. Again, a man will rise to the level of a lot of things, the level of that voice and that volume in his life, especially if it's affirmation or validation from his lady.
And ladies, if you want the same from your man, you know, you receive what you give.
Mm-hmm.
It's the law of the universe. This is the way life works. If you want him to be validating, you want him to be affirmative and give you those positive reinforcements, positive vibes,
yeah,
you need to give some out.
Yeah.
Back and forth sort of thing. And sometimes we guys can be a little linear and single-minded, and we might need a few hints,
mm-hmm.
We might need a few examples, and then we'll be like, oh, that's nice. Oh, and then we'll get it.
Yeah.
Not as quick on the uptake as you ladies all the time.
Yeah.
But we're real good at staying focused and getting stuff done. So, you know, give and take. But that's a two-way street. The positive validations mean you're the safe haven for each other. You're each other's vacation from the world. You're each other's cheerleader.
Mm-hmm.
This is a partnership. This is a loving relationship. I mean, these are the things what we're all hoping for.
Yeah.
We're going to get in our relationship and seldom do because we aren't communicating.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm telling you, man. I mean, that is so daggone huge, man. Especially, like I said, for a man to hear that cheerleading voice, man. And so, you know, these six V's, to be totally honest, these six V's are exactly how pornography becomes so captivating to a man, because all of these six V's are wrapped up in that: the visualization, the variety, the vitality, the victory, the vacation, and the validation. And guys are wired chemically, neurologically, psychologically, emotionally, even spiritually for those kinds of things. And so, I mean, that stuff is huge, is absolutely huge, man. And so I don't know. What do you think, JB? Did we drop some dimes? Did we do any good doing this conversation?
I think we did a lot of good, but I think we're also going to get a lot more questions, which that's good. We want to have your questions, and we want you to tell us what you want, because the ladies who were telling us they want us to talk about sex and male sexuality, that's still a pretty broad subject. So we decided to go with the six V's because Kurtz has this in his tool bag, and it's a great way of kind of giving us some structure to this talk. But I know you have more questions.
Mm-hmm.
You have more things you want to ask, so ask us. We will do those too.
Put them in the comments. Put them in the comments down there, man. You know, we'll respond. We'll reply. We'll respond. Hit us up on social media. Hit us up on Facebook. Share this. Like this. Subscribe. All of those kind of good things. But, you know,
we're about an hour, so you can have the ladies over for a watch party, watch on YouTube, and you know, it might be a very educational, fun evening.
I'm telling you, I'm pretty sure we did drop some kind of behind the scenes secrets here tonight, though, man, of tips that both men, but especially ladies, can do to, you know, in the area of, or understand anyway, in the area of sexuality. But we as men are wired in some very specific ways. I like to say that we're like a safe, and that dial, that combination, has a whole lot of numbers on that dial. Once you find the combination doesn't change.
Yeah.
It might be a whole lot of numbers on there. You might have to go this number, then back past it, then one this way and all that kind of stuff. But once you find the combination doesn't change. We're pretty. And when you open that combination, you got inside the safe. Yeah. There's safety in there.
If we're gonna give you the recap bullet points here, yes, the six V's, you can write those down. You can keep those. Those are, can go both ways. But really, safety, communication, and being each other's cheerleader and positive vibe. You want to be able to communicate. You've got to be able to communicate if you want to have a successful relationship. You want to be able to communicate safely and be that safe port, safe haven for each other. And you want to be each other's cheerleader. Mm-hmm. If you're not being those things, if you're just at each other, then do yourself a favor and go find somebody else.
Yeah. Yeah. And let's have some sex conversations if you're in a relationship. Yeah. Even if you haven't had sex yet in a relationship, have some conversations. Yeah. Talk about it. If we can't open up and talk about sex in the context of a relationship, then, you know, we're probably not going to be fulfilled in that area together.
Yeah, sometimes I bring it up too soon in a dating thing, but I want to know, like, what do you like? What are yeses for you? What are noes for you? What are things? Because I'm telling you guys, you don't want to find out in the midst, like, oops, that was wrong. That might ruin the whole night. You want to talk about this up front. And if you're an adult, you can have this conversation. If you can't have this conversation, I don't know if we can help you.
And it's like, have you ever done this? Have you ever done that? And go to find those limits, find those boundaries. And once you find the boundaries, then you know, like, okay, we can play all in this area. And maybe some of those boundaries, maybe it's like, I have it, but I consider it, or I have and I didn't like it, or I've done that and I like it. But either way, to have those, you know, push the limits and figure out, like, you know, ask some risque stuff. And what about this? What about that? And if the answer is like, nah, then it is what it is. But to be able to have these conversations, we got to be able to have open sex conversations in the context of a relationship.
You got to have the conversations to build the trust to be that safe place for each other. And to be able, and if you do want to explore and you do want to push your own boundaries and you do want to learn new things and you know, study tantra or anal play or get toys, or if you don't
go get a ball gag.
Yeah. I mean, if you need to go get the swing and the handcuffs and stuff,
whatever you got to do,
you have to. I mean, you don't break out the whips and chains without a safe word. So if you're not being safe with each other and trusting each other and talking about these things, then, you know, it's not going to be very exciting. There's not going to be a lot of variety because you're only going to do what you feel is safe.
Yeah.
And ladies, if you want your guy to be more freaky, you got to let him know.
Yeah. Go to a store that sells, you know, sex novelties. I don't want to say sex shop. I don't know if that means something to different people, but go to a place that sells toys and novelties and, you know, pick up things and discuss, like, well, would this feel, you know, and because, I mean, women know what feels good on them and what doesn't. You know, most women, from what I've understood on documentaries and stuff, have a really hard time, if possible, just having orgasm from penetration. So a lot of them need, you know, clit stimulation. And so if you look at, you know, just some toys, well, would this feel good? Would that feel good? Oh, yeah, I like that. And ooh, like that. And, you know, then you get to be able to have these conversations and explore that stuff, man. But
and be willing while it's still new and awkward and stuff like that to be open and talk during sex. Like, does this feel good? Do you like that? Do you like it like this? And try things out. I mean, that's the whole point of dating and coming together anyway, is really the exploration. So explore. I've been telling you from experience, guys, I made the mistake of, you know, yes, I've trained myself, I've learned, I've become good in the sack. But that's going to change with each woman.
Right. And
sometimes you come in like, I know what I'm doing.
Right. But no. Like,
not quite.
So, yeah, it's going to be different for everybody. It's going to be different for every experience and all that kind of stuff, man. But it all starts with that open conversation. And if you can have an open conversation about that, you can have an open conversation about anything. Hey, man, how can people get a hold of you? We got a few seconds left, man. How can people get a hold of you, man, if they want to?
Easiest way, right here. Whoops, I'm over here, right there. Mm. Hit me up on the website. Find me on social media, Jason B. Kendrick on Facebook, on LinkedIn, on Instagram. And if you look up Jason B. Kendrick on YouTube, and you can even type in Mad Men of Masculinity on YouTube, and you'll find these videos. This video will be on YouTube. Boom. We may not even share it on Facebook because of the content. Mm-hmm. And so if you're looking for me, you might find this guy. But if you're not looking for me, look for this guy.
Right there, KirkMSamuels.com. Boom, there it is right there.
Hold you, Kirk.
Oh, man, same thing. Facebook, phone number 720-515-6536. I'm trying to hurry up because we got time running out. But, yeah, man, we're out here.
An extra minute because we got stuff we got to promote.
Yeah, we're out here just trying to help the world and have these open dialogues and conversations. Let us know what you want to hear about, and we'll be glad to continue these dialogues, man.
And for those of you who like the videos, share the videos, comment, and then if you want to see us in person, I'll be doing a couple of different events. There's the Mr. Nice Guy and Superwoman Summit at the Unity Temple here in Denver on April 4th from noon to 3, and then this gentleman and I, the Mad Men of Masculinity as a duo, will be speaking individually at the Denver Singles Summit. Mm-hmm.
And so, if you're watching this 20 years from now, you can probably find us, you can probably find us out there somewhere, but we'll be still out here trying to change the world, man.
They'll already know who we are. We'll be
we might have, no doubt. All right, JBK. Love you, man. Appreciate you, brother. We'll keep doing good stuff.
See y'all. Have some good sex. Communicate. Be safe.
Have good sex. Have good sex.
Have good sex.
Get freaky. Do whatever you want.
World.
Yeah. Do it.
Peace.